In music, though, one doesn't make the end of a composition the point of the composition. If that were so, the best conductors would be those who played fastest. And there would be composers who wrote only finales. People go to a concert just to hear one crashing chord, because that's the end.
In 2012, skinny, angry little white boy from Georgia reached out for coaching. He ended up being Travis Mayer. I always laugh because he was, I think he was 21 or 22 at the time. And in this sport, I think in all sports, people come on board and they're like, I want to make the games. And they're all serious and ready to do all the work. And then you're like, oh, okay, this is what you have to do for training. And then a couple months in, they're like, I don't want to make the games anymore. It's too hard. But every once in a while, you get an athlete that comes on board that is willing to do that. And that was Travis. I went through his initial testing, and his movement quality was just absolutely horrendous. Snatch technique, his posture was awful. Like, there were just so many issues that we needed to work on. But there were two just fundamental qualities of a high-level athlete in this sport that I knew that he possessed. First was just a massive aerobic system. I think he had a 6:30 Helen time at the time that we started, and he had like raw strength levels where they were needed to be. I think he was already at like a 475 pound deadlift, and he was only 180, 185 pounds in the 2011 regional when he was, or open, he was 61st. And I always joke around with him that I was in that regional and beat him in the only CrossFit competition we've ever done together. And then in 2012, he had broken L5, I think, broken one of the vertebrae in his back or fractured it. And then that offseason hired me. And I knew that he was games caliber in terms of some of his fitness metrics, but I'd never seen him compete before. You know, I'd never seen him really train in person. Some of his metrics looked like they were improving, but we knew there were still some holes in his game that we didn't know if we could fill in. And he actually ended up in that first year making it to the games. And he had improved at such a rapid pace in that period of time. It was just a cool year. I mean, zero expectations going in. The first individual athlete that I had taken in the sport from a, you know, from an unknown level to become a games athlete. I think he finished 18th that year, which is a pretty good year. And then the quest has just kind of been, you know, it's been a challenging road with Travis, and Travis is extremely strong-willed, extremely hardworking athlete. Went back in 2014, and I think the pressure and just the expectations and the amount of hard training that we did leading in kind of put some pressure on him, and just having a slow start there kind of undermined his confidence. He ended up having a bad year in 2014. And then I think that set a negative tone going into 2015. And even though his fitness metrics had been improving at such a fast rate, he kind of lost his competitive edge in 2015. And obviously we worked on that. We hired sports psychologists. Like, we're constantly trying to get better and constantly working on the details and execution of Olympic lifts and pacing and the details, his nutrition, and pretty much everything had been a focus. And 2015 just ended up being a horrible year. He ended up not qualifying for the games and just having a bad regional experience. It wasn't that the tests were bad necessarily, but just wasn't, It didn't pan out. He made some execution errors. I'm sure I could take some responsibility for planning errors in his training. And then I think that experience was a catalyst for him to kind of become the high-level athlete that is competing right now. I think it just put him into a different mind state. Obviously, every athlete's at risk now at regionals. I know high-level athletes like Josh Bridges and Dan Bailey haven't made it back to the games during the regional level, so it's not an uncommon thing for people that are really good not to make it, but it was a driver for him. And then leading into 2016, he just changed. He changed psychologically. He decided that it was time to start taking his training seriously, start to focus on the details, stop blaming people, He listened to everything that I said and made decisions as a grown adult as to what he wanted to listen to and what he didn't want to listen to. And he kind of started developing his own adult autonomy. He became a father. He took over his gym business. And it's just been really cool to watch that. I think the 10th place finish he had at the games this past year in 2016 was reflective of his capacity. And like all competitions, I go through an analysis and look at them and do like, hey, this is what you did well, this is what you did poorly, this is what you need to work on. And I really believe with the workout structure that came out last year, he probably could have finished substantially higher than 10th. I don't know how high he could have been. I know Matt Frazier was an absolute beast last year with regards to the gap that he had on second. So I'm not going to say anything crazy like he could have won the games. But I know that he could have finished higher than 10th. And I think that kind of motivated him and fueled him to have a good competitive off season. And then being one and done this year in the Open and being able to stay low stress and set himself up for a big hard push for regionals to secure another spot for the games, it sets the stage for a potential really successful year for him.
We thought of life by analogy with a journey, with a pilgrimage, which had a serious purpose at the end, and the thing was to get to that end, success or whatever it is, or maybe heaven after you're dead. But we missed the point the whole way along. It was a musical thing, and you were supposed to sing or to dance while the music was being played.
Travis is relentless. I mean, people don't see it. He doesn't show that because he's not like a really emotional person on the surface. He doesn't like open up the way that most people see it. But once you get to know him, you realize that he is one of the most relentless competitors, I think, in the sport. He feels like everyone looks down on him. He feels like everyone, you know, has spurned him in some way. And all he wants to do is push and prove himself. Prove everyone wrong, prove that he belongs there. And most people who've already been to the games, they lose that fire. He has that burning all the time. And you see it every day in his training. You see it every day in the way that he competes. And I think that's really one of the things that sets Travis, you know, apart from all the other athletes that I've seen at the games level, at the regional level. He's just hungrier, he's pissed, and he carries that around all the time. Like I said, Travis's Open this past year was so impressive. The fact that he was able to go out, do each workout one time, find his groove. This is the first time he's ever had to do that. He's ever had to just accept that he was going to go out and do the workouts one time. And the fact that he, like in week three, was able to turn in a pretty damn incredible score, and week four turn in a really damn incredible score on his first attempt, I think that was just a real testament to Travis's fire.
What I've noticed is that the athletes who are most diligent about details, focus in training, reporting results, how their nutrition's affecting their body, what their movement quality looks like, and every little thing that goes into performance are the people that at the end of the Open feel good about their performances, and oftentimes are also the people that are winning and accomplishing their goals.
I think people in CrossFit, and it's one of those things with the culture, right? It's like we always think that I have to go as hard as possible, and if I go as hard as possible, I'll get my best score. But that's not the case anymore, because all the top guys can go hard as possible, and all the top guys are tough. But what makes the best guys is the way that they execute going hard as possible. So in other words, if you know Travis is doing a workout and Noah's doing it next to him, they're both the same and they both could get the same time. It's going to come down to who executes the movements the best, and that's who's going to win the workout, right? It's not about, let me just push myself and get into the pain cave, which is kind of like, you know, I should wear a badge of honor because I gritted through this workout and I'm tough. That's not the case anymore. You know, in 2011, maybe you could get away with that, but now it's, you got to be tough, but you also have to be mentally prepared to execute every single rep in a workout, have your body in the right place, make sure you're moving well, make sure that you're opening up all the little things before a workout so that every single squat, every single double under, every single, you know, thruster that you're doing is perfect so that each rep counts every single time.
I think it's just, it's easier for somebody to say, if I put in enough work, it'll pay off. And I think that the sport has evolved past that already. You know, we're 10 years old at this point, but I think that the momentum that the sport has as a whole has just evolved past that. And it's not enough to just say, I'm going to just shotgun this guy with volume and hope that things take care of themselves. You have to be more analytical, you have to be more objective, and you have to really refine those individual components of that skill in order to gain long-term success and improvement.
Just watching and reviewing videos from my athletes, you could see like such a discrepancy in people that have practiced the movement versus people who have trained the movement. And what I mean by that are the people that practiced it, they take time, they slow down, they've thought about how they're moving versus just trying to do it as quickly as possible every time, or even trying to make it so that it hurts as bad, you know, as much as it possibly can each time they do a movement. So it's like, I just noticed an overall or an overarching theme that people that pay more attention, people that are more mindful, were more successful, and the results, you know, definitely spoke for themselves.
If you look at other sports, right? So like I played football. Every single week from after our games on Saturdays, so Sunday we were in the film room talking about the next team. What do they do that we can expose? How do we make different adjustments on defense or on offense to be able to expose the coverages that they're playing on defense or the blocking schemes that they're having on offense? And we would come up with a game plan to make the most out of that next week, right? And then we would also be proactive in how are we going to make adjustments during the game? So if a team moves coverages on defense, then what are we going to do on offense to be able to expose those coverages? In the same way, CrossFitters need to think, right? If this workout comes out, how am I going to place my rope down to be able to be the most efficient on each transition? I need to grab the rope, step on the end, place the handles down, immediately turn 90 degrees, grab the barbell and get into my thrusters, right? When I put the bar down, I'm going to step back on a half 90 degree turn, grab my rope and go right into my first jump. Thinking about those things matters so much now that everybody is so good at the top.
What's going to draw people towards a volume approach versus a focused, deliberate practice approach is because the return on investment, like the timeline, is extended. So if they go into the gym and they say, I'm going to do 30 minutes of double under work every time before I start my session, they feel like they're doing work. They feel like they're being productive there. And that immediate sort of gratification is what enables them to sort of stay on with that process. When you break the components down, you have to keep them isolated for a relatively long period of time in order to refine them. And so the timeline for that return on investment is extended. So it's harder for somebody to basically say, I'm going to stay patient in the short term because I know it's going to pay off in the long run. It doesn't feel as productive as the volume approach does, especially in the short term.
Well, yeah, I think the best way to illustrate it is when we bring on a new athlete, anytime we have new athletes start, the first thing that they have to understand is that their movement has to get better. If they want to get better in the sport, they have to become more efficient. They have to become more economical with their movements, learn to make everything cost less. But it is a process, and it is a really boring process, and there's no formula for developing that.
The performance, the optimal performance, the target that we place on going faster is more than just pain tolerance. It's more than just movement quality. It's more than just technical analytics of a workout to figure out transition times. It's all of that. It's all of those details all of the time, and it's a learned behavior. I think people think that, oh, here's this target, and you shoot an arrow at it and you just hit it. And it's not like that. It's like starting out in a blind room that has no lights and the target's somewhere on the wall. And you shoot, and every time you graze something of a target, a little bit of light comes on the room that gives you more focus as to how to get closer and closer and closer to that. And the course of a career finally illuminates the room 10 years later, where you're like, oh, there's all these targets, let's get them together, and now I can actually be precise and actually perform. It's a process, and it takes a really long time to figure out what's the level of excitement that's required, what's the level of aggression that's required, what risks do I take in this workout, how fast do I transition, how do I make sure I maintain my technical precision when I'm tired, what types of tired can I push through mentally, and what types of tired, if I push through, do I blow up and I can't feel my hands. All of those things are learned behaviors, and a coach doesn't know them ahead of time. We're not omnipotent where we can be like, oh, well, you didn't do well because of this, 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 and this. You do it, and it's like, these are the areas of performance. Let's try some strategies to get them better. And it's an experimental process over time. Now, the people who are successful long-term are the people who constantly experiment to get better and better and better and better until they realize, I can't get any better. And I think that mind state is the mind state of a champion.
You know, going into the last 2 weeks, I think we'd made some pretty good predictions that the repeat this year was going to be a repeat of 16.4, that wall ball, deadlift, handstand push-up, you know, chipper workout. And then the last week, we know that it's going to have thrusters, and we hadn't seen double unders, so we knew the last week was probably going to be thrusters and double unders. So the last 2 weeks on that Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday block, we're just focusing on preparing for those movements, deadlift efficiency, handstand push-up touches, and then making sure people's double unders are dialed in and that they're feeling really sharp with thrusters. Because if you know they're coming, you better prepare for it.
That one was the redo, so everybody knew what to expect almost with that one. I think the handstand push-up standard changed things a little bit, but I was happy. I think a lot of my athletes improved, and a lot of them had weaknesses in that workout that we worked on in the off season, whether it was the deadlifts or the handstand push-ups, and I was really happy with how my group did with that one.
Yeah, I instantly became the best coach in America. I gave that to every single one of my athletes, I think. They had some sort of, like, you know, 15 deadlifts, 15 cal row, 15 wall ball, 15 handstand push-up. So everybody was texting me like, oh, you called it. But in reality, I was just hedging my bets. Those four movements hadn't come out yet. Those are good tests for the open. I assumed that they were going to come out either in week four or week five. So by giving those to them, I just gave them exposure to the movements. There really was no, you know, thought behind it other than let's hedge our bets and let's get these in there. So I think my athletes were prepared. I didn't have any athletes that did worse, which I think is a good indicator of them improving. And it's also an indicator of just their confidence. Like, I know I can do better than I did last year. The funny thing about that workout, and this is one of the things that I've had to talk to some of my athletes about, is changing their expectations. I had some athletes that, let's just say, give a number, they got 20 handstand push-ups last year. This year they got 35 or 40 handstand push-ups, but they were still disappointed because they didn't finish them. But if you took that workout and said, well, now it's a for time workout, and you improve by 20 handstand push-ups, that's about a minute and 30 or even 2 minutes of a workout for someone with that capacity. And so one of the things I told them was, if this was the thruster burpee workout from last year and you improved that by 2 minutes, how good would you feel? And every single one of them said, I feel awesome, right? Of course they would, because a 2 minute improvement in a workout is huge. But when it comes to those kind of AMRAP style workouts, or when you're looking at others in the field that did 20 deadlifts and you did 40 handstand pushups, I think the thought is, well, I expect to be as good as them. But the reality is you can only look at yourself and say, well, I improved by 20 handstand pushups, and that's 2 minutes increased on time. I did a good job. And so that was kind of one of the things I had to work through on that workout.
If you weren't expecting a redo, you haven't been around the sport long enough, you should have been retesting these things in the off season. and you should have past video open for analysis for you to be able to go back in and improve your effort. So I'd love to see it come out. It was one that I think I had given to almost all of my athletes as a redo, and I think almost everybody improved on it. And I think a lot of it is going to come down to the work that you're willing to put in the off season to do the things properly.
Well, if you remember, leading into week four, I sent out an email to my entire group of athletes that were completing the open. And one of the things I mentioned in there is that by the end of week four, 80% of the scores are in. You know, there's only 20% can change. So a good score on week four is like your last opportunity to make a jump. And so I just made sure that everyone was very clear. If they're on the bubble or if they're feeling safe, you're not safe yet. You're not safe until after week four. That's like that's when the open ends. And then in the last week, like unless you shit the bed and you know, completely screw up, there's no way you're pulling yourself up from 30th to a top 20 spot. So at the, you know, I made sure to make very clear to everybody that this is your last opportunity. And it just turns out that it was a repeat. So everyone kind of knew what they were getting into going into the workout. And for, I would say the vast majority of my athletes, handstand pushups were a weakness for them in the previous years, regardless of whether they were someone that I had worked with in the past or if they were a new athlete coming on board. For some reason, that workout, that, you know, 16.4, 17.4 repeat, just exposes people's handstand pushup inefficiency so well. Something that doesn't get tested in like a 50 strict handstand pushups or a 50 kipping handstand pushups for time. And that's something that I had addressed really well, not a coaching bias in there for this workout. And, you know, I saw some amazing improvement from some of my athletes. Athletes had good scores last year, adding 50 reps on the workout. And like, again, you can't help but like just kind of smile about that when you're coming away. You're like, man, you had a good score last year. And this year you're like, you've moved yourself into the elite ranks. So I was confident when the workout was released. And I think the results again of that week, it cemented a bunch of people into their qualifying spots, which I think was awesome. One of the things I love about the repeats is they're just honest. You know what I mean? If you are retesting the same workout that you did the year before and you improve, it's hard to argue that you're not better than you were the year before. And if you didn't improve, it's hard as a coach to explain to the athlete why that happened, especially if you know, you did everything that you could to help them prepare and they didn't improve. That's a tough situation to be in, but I think it provides more of that honesty that we talked about.
So this is probably my favorite event out of everything in the open, not because I really just love the test as it was. I just thought it was pretty cool to see exactly how someone compares from last year to this year. With the sport of CrossFit and kind of how we define fitness, I could have had an athlete get better at 16.1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and by every objective measure from the previous year, they're fitter. But if the testing battery changes and the types of events change, they could have gotten fitter by every metric we used and not performed as well this year as last year. And that's just a product of the sport being like constantly varied, kind of randomized, and the whole idea that you need to be prepared for chaos. So I like having that objective number from year to year so you could actually see, all right, maybe you didn't perform as well as you wanted to on 17.2 or 3, but you might have not prepared for that specifically, where this event that you did last year, if you get 20 reps higher, by all objective measures, you're a better athlete.
People look at the handstand pushups, they look at the deadlifts. They think, man, I've just got to hammer deadlifts if that's my limiter when I get back there. They think I've just got to be able to do handstand pushups under fatigue. Really, I think we have to take a little bit broader view on what the actual limitation there was. And I think a lot of it comes down to people being able to breathe in positions under tension and not panic. So the work that you do in the off season is going to be reflective of that. Not just, hey, did you do your 10 by 10 deadlifts at 225 this week? It's, did you do your positional breathing work under tension in those positions that are then going to be reflective and allow you to be comfortable and calm when the panic sets in?
Finished that workout with 304 reps, I want to say, which was 11 reps less than I had done previously, but it was better than my first attempt last year. So it's kind of somewhere in the middle of my first attempt and the retest, which was a little bit hard of a pill to swallow, because for some people that retested and did better, they're like, hey, I got fitter, I got a lot better. And so in my mind for a second, I was thinking, wait, so am I less fit? Did I not get better? And obviously that's not the case. There are so many factors, like being in a different environment, how much sleep did I get, what did I eat, what song was on while I was doing the workout, you know? So I tried not to get wrapped up in the fact that I technically did a little bit worse than I had done on that workout previously. And again, just kind of wrap it up and move on. Had some fun with these guys, spent some time up in Atlanta, and moved on to crush the final workout of the Open.
17.4 was a roller coaster of an experience. We had four games athletes competing head to head in the workout. So Noah came into town, who's my athlete, to work out. Travis obviously is here, who's my athlete. And then Jacob and Alex Anderson came in. All four of them went after it. We knew from the prior year, Travis had taken second in the world and he was one rep behind Froning. So we knew it was going to be a good workout for Travis. And I think the extra energy of having, you know, Noah, who's on his team that he wants to beat, and other games athletes coming into his environment, was an opportunity for him to get even like more fired up and intense at a time for a games athlete in the Open where it's not really the time of the year to dip into that intensity. But for a young athlete, it's an opportunity to win $2,000, get into the media, get like visibility for sponsors. So Travis really went out of that workout with the intention that he was going to win the world. And we knew that it was a possibility, which is cool, because a lot of people, I think, go out with the intention that they're going to win and they don't get anywhere close. So he crushed it. He absolutely destroyed the workout.
He was just pumped and motivated. And I got a text message at work once he finished, and he was just floored with how he did and his performance. So he was checking the leaderboard, a little nervous and anxious, because he made that commitment to himself that he wasn't going to redo any of the workouts. So he was hoping that he came in second the first time they did it, that he could hopefully win and come in first this year.
The best way to look at this with Travis in week four, you know, he went in, he had a mission to crush this workout, to crush week four. It was a workout that just combines a bunch of elements he's really good at: wall ball, deadlift, handstand pushups, rowing. I mean, that's like his bread and butter. And so I think he had a lot of fire going into the week, and he went in there and performed out of his mind. I mean, if just watch the video, you know, anyone who's seen it is like, damn, that is some serious work that he's doing all the way across the board. And the result was so damn impressive. And we submitted and, you know, got in the leaderboard and we started watching. And, you know, each time a new name was submitted, we're like, all right, he's still at top, still at top, still at top. And by the end of the week, we're like, Travis took it. All right, we did it. You know, Travis ended up taking the top spot going into the week. And we started to celebrate. And Travis, he was on top of the world, because that was his goal. His goal was to win the world for week four.
And the guy who won 17.4, Travis Mayer, Pat, a guy maybe we don't give enough credit for some of his performances.
We're 100% guilty of that. I mean, we do this for a living, and if we walked around the halls of the office and we're like, where did Travis Mayer finish?
After Monday, we thought he won the world. I mean, we looked at the video. We saw one, like, with absolute certainty, no rep, but he had a lead in the workout. I think he had beaten Frazier by two or three reps, and he had a lead. So, and we knew within the rules that you could have up to five no reps without the workout score being deducted, so they would just deduct those reps. And so we looked at the video and we concluded, like, hey, we think this is pretty good, and we're pretty excited about it.
Yeah, so then we get the update show, and you know, Travis is top of the world. He's on it. You know, they're like, Travis Mayer this week turns in the best performance, and then all of a sudden we get the video review, and it's just like down. But honestly, Travis handled it extremely well. To go from a high like that, like, hey, I just won the world. I'm the best in the world at this. That feels good. Like, there's a feeling that comes with that, you know, it's really hard to mimic. And then all of a sudden, just to have it taken away, whether or not you feel like that was legitimate that he had it taken away, it still hurts.
Like, I've heard this analogy before. When your team is in the Super Bowl, if they lose to, or in the playoffs, and they lose to the team that ends up winning the Super Bowl, it's not that bad, right? Because they're super good and they won. So when Travis beat me up here, I was kind of bummed out. But then when I found out that he had the best score in the world, I was like, oh, all right, maybe I shouldn't be as bummed out, because that's a pretty damn good score. And was really proud of him and excited that I got to be there and witness that and kind of do that against him. And maybe even, who knows, I don't know if I can claim this, but push him a little bit to get that really, really high score. I'm sure we all pushed each other. But a couple days later, when they revoked his score, I was kind of taken aback, and I text Max, and he said he didn't know too much about it. So I went and I read the article and I watched the video, and I don't know. I mean, I was actually surprised by how good his reps did look. Like, to me, on the deadlifts, I think that's probably one of the most questionable movements. I admit that there were even some where I rushed it a little bit and maybe my shoulders didn't get all the way back and I did get a couple no reps, but looked like some good reps. And I'm sure that it was frustrating for him to have that taken away, because I don't know about him, I've never won an open workout outright. I won the open, but I've never won an individual workout. And not only do you get a little bit of credit on the website and all that, but I think you get like 2000, whatever a year it is, you get that amount in money. So he would have had $2,017. So that kind of sucks that all of those were stripped away. And we know how he is. I'm sure that just fueled him a little bit to kind of come back and seek revenge.
It's so easy to get angry at something like that. Oh, well, this is bullshit. Like, these reps were good. We followed the rules. Like, and all of that stuff could potentially be true, but truth is relative. So it already happened. It's over. Do I want to go fight it? No. I mean, what's the benefit of that? And is Travis going to get anything by creating enemies by saying, oh, I'm pissed off about this, or this is unfair, or feeling, you know, sorry for himself? So I kind of put my foot down on the issue with Travis, and I sat down with him like, look, you're in week four of the open. You've been one and done in the workouts, which is what our intention of the week of the open was to get you into the final heat, just going one at a time on the workouts, not wasting extra emotional and mental energy at a time of the year that you don't need to. And nothing's changed. Yes, you lost $2,000. Yeah, you could, you know, make a big stink about this, but all of that wasted emotion is not going to help you get better. So instead, bottle that frustration up, put it into your training every single day from now until regionals. Go out on 17.5 and absolutely destroy it. And don't waste your time thinking about what could have been. It's already over. It's past. Focusing on the negative is not helpful. So we kind of redirected his mind state pretty quickly about it. Now, doesn't mean it didn't hurt. It doesn't mean you didn't go through this like radical emotional experience where we're like, hey, yeah, this is awesome. And then we're like, ah, fuck. Like, you know, but life's kind of out of our control. And sports, I think in general, are out of our control. And one of the major reasons we play is because it offers us a platform to actually feel.
I think he was able to turn that, I don't want to say loss, but in his mind, that was a huge loss, into a positive, just because that made him realize that he has to be perfect on everything. Like, there's no room for error. And if he's feeling tired in a workout, like, he can't let up at all. And I think finally getting to that point where he allows himself to almost like redline and push to his limits is something that he's been struggling with. And I think that having like that taste of like what it is to be number one, having that taken away from him really like fueled that fire for him.
Even looking back on it now, knowing it didn't end the way it we wanted it to, was still an awesome experience. And I think it's gonna fire him up to, because he's got a taste of victory and now he knows what he's competing for. So I like to look at it as a positive and try to spin it in a way that helps us all get better. Up against the wall, there's something dying on the street. When they knock you down, you're gonna get back on your feet. Cause you can't stop now, cause you can't stop now. Did they break your heart? Did they break your heart? And did they cause your soul? Put us on the moon, remember what I said. Remember what I said. Boy, you was bad, you were battle-born. Cause you can't stop now, cause you can't stop now. Come on, show your face, come on, show your face. Come on, give us one, give us one spark. We'll sing a song of fire. Let's be falling to the dark.
Because music, as an art form, is essentially playful. We say you play the piano. You don't work the piano. Why? Music differs from, say, travel. When you travel, you are trying to get somewhere. And of course, we, because being a very compulsive and purposive culture, are busy getting everywhere faster and faster and faster till we eliminate the distance between places. I mean, with the modern jet travel, you can arrive almost instantaneously. What happens as a result of that is that the two ends of your journey become the same place. So you eliminate the distance, and you eliminate the journey. Because the fun of the journey is to travel, not to obliterate travel. So then, in music, though, one doesn't make the end of a composition the point of the composition.
You should definitely use this in the video. Travis is the toughest pussy I've ever met in my life.